have our last speaker for the evening. Pronita Saxena is the founder and CEO of Citizengage, a Bangalore-based technology company building the world's first waste-to-resource grid that channels waste into energy, compost, and recycled products. Pronita was recently named one of India's top women entrepreneurs by Cosmopolitan and was also a TEDx speaker. I would urge all of you to look up her TEDx talk. It is rich in data and insights. Prior to Citizengage, Pronita was co-founder of India's first civic tech startup, creating a water information grid. And before moving back to India, she was employee number one at a manufacturing efficiency startup at Techstars Boston. After earning her degree in economics at UC Berkeley, Pronita worked at MIT's Poverty Action Lab in rural Bangladesh and contributed to several policy papers for the World Bank and IMF at the Center for Global Development in Washington, D.C. About Citizengage, Citizengage has recently been nominated as one of the 25 nominees for the Postcode Lottery Green Challenge, the world's largest competition in the field of sustainable entrepreneurship that had over 515 entrepreneurs apply from 85 countries this year. Citizengage was the only company from India and also the only one representing Asia. Earlier this year, Germany's Clean Energy Agency selected Citizengage from over 500 companies across 60 countries among platforms and communities creating the energy transition. And last year, it was also covered at Your Story. One more interesting fact which I would also want to share here is that Humingtree and Citizengage also work together towards waste collection, and Pronita will definitely be talking more about that. Over to you, Pronita.
Thank you, and as one of my friends here said, since we're all at a bar and I think we're having some backbencher issues, I wanted to start by playing a drinking game with all of you. It's called Two Truths and a Lie. So I'm going to make three statements. Two of them are true, one of them is a lie. And you have to figure out what the lie is. So every time you think that I'm lying, you have to take a sip of your drink and raise your hand. All right? Okay, so the first statement is, the humming tree produces less than 50 kg of waste on a daily basis. Who thinks that's a lie? Okay, all right, we have a few of those. All right, second statement. Bangalore produces over 4,000 tons of waste per month. Oh, sorry, per day. Who's drinking? I don't see any hands. Okay, nobody, okay, few hands, all the backbenchers are, I think, drinking. Okay, then the third point, humming tree's waste is producing electricity. How many think that's a lie? Okay, Sarvesh, Srikant, the operations team is here, please walk those people out, because actually that's the truth. And that's what I actually want to get into. So Citizengage is building the world's first waste-to-resource grid. And the other two facts, the only lie here was actually that an establishment that all of us are enjoying tonight, like Humming Tree, produces almost 200 kgs of waste every single day. And if you look at India as a whole, although we produce 85% of our waste could be recycled, but over 90% is sitting in landfills. And this is even more frustrating because if you take all of the organic waste that Bangalore produces in a day, which is almost 60%, and you fed it into a biogas plant that produced CNG, you could fuel almost double the number of bus trips that the city's entire fleet makes on a daily basis. Now, how many think this is actually happening? Okay, nobody's drinking now, right? So it's not happening, right? And I think that's really the frustration that Ashish, my co-founder, and I shared and said, you know, this is stupid and somebody needs to do something about this. And that was the birth of our company called Citizengage. And basically, you must be wondering why, you know, systematically we are not able to solve this problem. I'll give you three reasons. So the first one is that we have not really looked at biogas as a scalable technology. We've not invested in it. Everywhere across the world, you basically have landfills. So these are just dump sites where the waste is going and is stored and we just forget about it and pretend like it doesn't exist. Or we basically burn it up. So these are the two things that we're largely doing all across the world, including in Europe and in the US. So there is no system that, you know, can be a platform for recycling economies or the circular economy at scale. And I really commend, you know, the earlier speakers, hacker spaces and maker and make spaces are really important. But we really look at how do you scale these solutions in the future. Is Anirudh here? So Anirudh from Graphic Labs. Okay, I want everyone to look back there because that's someone who has actually solved the air pollution problem. So you must look up Anirudh because he has a device that can actually take air pollution out and give you really cool ink. And you should go and buy this product. But apart from that, what we want to do is really serve as a grid for these kinds of processing solutions. So if you guys come up with a really cool way to utilize paper, plastic, metal, and repurpose it into something, that's exactly the kind of technology that we need to have more investment in. However, waste is not getting to these kinds of facilities, and therefore you're not getting scale in processing solutions. Now the second problem is even if someone like Anirudh wanted to get information about where he can find the carbon to create his ink, the data just doesn't exist. So when we think about real-time supply chain management, it's nearly impossible to do it in waste management anywhere in the world because we haven't even thought about profiling restaurants like Humming Tree or any other place like a tech park. What are you producing? How much of it? What can be done with it? Nobody's actually figured this out. There are no standards to produce this data. Now the last issue is really around behavior change. So if you can imagine all of us are here enjoying a great night and you know everyone's drinking, people are going to be eating. So obviously there might be a fluctuation in what Humming Tree is producing as waste, right? Normally no one would know that. Nobody would actually be able to tell you how much does Humming Tree produce on an average night. Now you also have to look in the back. There are the bartenders, there are all of us, there are a lot of stakeholders involved. There are the guys who come and collect the garbage at night from down below. There are the guys who, from the Humming Tree team, who actually place it downstairs. Then it has to get to the facility. So on and on and on. So you can think about all the people that actually impact what happens to Humming Tree's waste, right? If you cannot manage everyone's behavior, the system fails. You will not be able to recycle as much as is theoretically possible. So I'm really proud to say that using the Citizengage platform, we've been able to divert over 10,000 tons of waste from landfills to date. We're managing almost 1,000 tons a month. So, thank you. And the best part is actually 86% of our customers' waste never touches the landfill. And if you guys go to Domlur Park, that entire park is lit up by organic waste from restaurants in Indranagar like Humming Tree. So, yay. So it's really exciting because that showed the world that, you know, this model is scalable. And I personally, I think I heard another bear, go bears, someone in the back, woohoo. So, I mean, I moved back to India because of this specific reason that, you know, we really wanted to work on innovation at a global scale from India. I hate to say it, but you know, we're the world's largest democracy, yet at times it feels like we don't think that we can innovate from here at a global scale. We're just looking at copy-paste entrepreneurship, and that's really what we're trying to change with Citizengage. And I think this is where all of you come in, because if you really want to help us, there's a lot that we need to do now, because now we're actually looking at scaling beyond Bangalore. So I'll probably save that for questions, I'm sure. I hope you have lots, because there's a lot that I have not covered. So I'd rather save time for more questions. Thank you so much for having me join you today.
Hi, for sharing such a wonderful project with us. I have a lot of questions, but I'll start with, I want to ask, I misunderstand. You are converting organic waste, as in like the biodegradable waste or non-biodegradable?
Everything. So our aim is to sign up a company, an establishment like Humming Tree, and say, okay, great. Our objective as Citizengage is to help you maximally convert all of your waste into a resource of some form. So the majority of the waste in India is organic, right? So there's a lot of food waste that would come out of here. So that is the majority of the waste. But you also have dry waste, which is what we normally think of as recyclable waste, so paper, plastic, metals, glass, blah, 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 blah. And then you have the third category, which is called reject waste, which is essentially stuff you can't do anything with. Part of that should be incinerated because it's biohazardous, right? So we basically come and build the entire system. So from the bin level, how many bins should you have? Where should you place the bins? Training your staff, making sure that you have
certain standards to follow, certain policies, escalation procedures, and training. So all of this is designed by us, and we are like a grid operator, right? So we then transport the waste in different streams. Everything which you're producing is controlled by us, and it's transferred to the different locations that can utilize it. And you have, I mean, all of our trucks are GPS tracked. We have reporting coming in from the facilities, so we can actually tell you what percent of your waste got recycled in any given month.
So what happened to the reject waste?
Yeah, so you can't, so reject waste by definition is waste that has to be incinerated or landfilled. So that's what I'm saying. So right now, less than 10% of our whole grid's waste is going to a landfill or a dump site, which is today, 10% is all that's being recycled in India. Right, so we've been able to flip that completely on its head. So 86% of our customers' waste is completely being recycled or reused.
So the reject waste, which is non-biodegradable, and you said
like non-recyclable.
Non-recyclable, okay. But the main concern is non-biodegradable, right? And you said that you use it on landfill. So I'm assuming that the rejectable waste is going into landfill, which is not decomposable.
Of course, so that's by definition, right? So what we're saying is this, so I really challenge people who think zero waste. I'd like you to really show me where it is zero waste, because what are you doing with diapers? What are you doing with, you know, so there you're always going to have waste that you can't do anything with, unfortunately. And at scale, that's a reality. All we can do is try to minimize that. And I have a really interesting example for you guys here to think about. So one great example is basically a rubber chappal. So if you throw out your rubber chappal on any given day, guarantee that's going to landfill. But if you can get a whole truck full of rubber chappals, that you can feed to a factory, right? So what also changes with scale is what can be recycled. So I'm 100% sure, like, as we grow as an organization, as we have more tons under management, and you're actually managing a specific grade of plastic in large enough volumes or other kinds of material, you can find uses for it. From the UK, where these folks figure out a way to reuse thermocore. It Tetra Pak is a great example. We weren't able to do anything with it before. Now it's being used as roofing material. So, you know, there is a lot of innovation that is possible. I would love to have that be like an open marketplace where we can say, hey guys, we have a lot of this stuff that's coming in as reject. We don't have anyone that is using it. Can someone figure this out? Right? But you want to have enough volumes where that becomes viable.
I have one more question.
Very inspiring stuff. And whatever you mentioned was at an organization level, like the ways that a place like this perform, like takes out, right? If you look at individual houses, for example, right now they're not segregating their waste. So at that point, I'm pretty sure you will want to have to partner with governments and such entities, right? How do you plan to go about that?
Great question. So right now we work with residential communities that are bulk generators. So these would be apartment complexes that are managed by an association. So we come and do the same thing that we would be doing for Humming Tree. We do at a household level there. So that's the good news. The bad news is that yes, we are not, there isn't really a legal framework for a startup to realistically participate in the government tender process. So, you know, shout out to the earlier speaker who talked about Make in India kind of being a publicity campaign. I think Startup India to some level has also been that. And there's actually a hilarious video of me asking this question at Startup India about really how do we get startups to participate in innovation with the government, right? I think that is still something, no government in the world, by the way, has really figured that out, right? Because anywhere you go for any kind of public service, because of the scale and the fact that with public money you can't take risk, right? Inherently, a startup won't even qualify for a tender. Now, we have done a lot of policy advocacy around standards and how the BBMP here can be, you know, using technology and all of that stuff, and we've done that totally pro bono. But it's not yet a model, because until we have a system where we can participate and expect to be paid on time by the government, it's not viable for startups to really be engaging that space. So unfortunately, for right now, it'll just be pro bono consulting that we can do. But I hear you. The good news is, okay, individual waste is also not the majority. Like 60% of Bangalore's waste comes from bulk generators. So at least in that sense, you know, we're like, okay, we're focusing on the bigger problem. But definitely for citizen engagement, you know, maybe have us help you where you work if you live in an individual household, or where you live if you're in an apartment community.
Okay, amazing stuff. So I'm still trying to wrap my head around what exactly is the Citizengage platform. You alluded to some of it, saying that you have GPS tracked trucks, etc. So, are you a waste management company? Are you an electricity producing company? Like, what exactly are you?
Great question. So, we're a grid operator. So, think of us kind of like as BESCOM, but for waste to resource conversion. So this is a lot of new kind of jargon I'm throwing at you guys, and I'm not allowed visuals, so I'll try to kind of paint this picture for you guys. So imagine a circle, right? And imagine there are three nodes in the circle. The first circle, or the first node, is people who are producing waste. So all of us here, right? Now, the third node over here is basically different facilities. So whether that's a biogas plant, whether that's a recycling center, a paper mill, a composting plant, whatever. Somebody who can take a particular type of waste that is produced in this node and utilize it in some way. Now, I have to get the waste from here to there. So that's when the third node comes in, which is the collector network. So this is, everybody uses Uber, Ola, you guys understand that. So we are applying that same concept, but it's only a third of what we are doing, right? Because it's just the connection. But what we also do is, see, you have to have certain systems to be able to make sure, so over 95% of our residential waste is segregated error-free at door and maintained that way by the time our collectors go and pick it up and by the time it reaches the processing facility, right? And it's over 90% in the commercial setting as well. So, some, of course, our system has to be maintained, right? And I think this is the big thing, that we don't think about waste management as a gridded system. We think about electricity that way, we think about water that way, we don't think about that as waste, right? So that's the biggest thing we're changing. And then imagine us as this like network operator that's saying, okay, you need to do this. Okay, take this here. Okay, there's mal over here. Please come and pick it up. Please take it further. So eventually, that's the basic layer of what we're doing. And then, you know, you go deeper into analytics in a particular vertical. So I'll give you a quick example. In the interest of time. So there's a cable company that we met in Europe. They have, you know, 18 different locations. And they just decided that, you know what, we want to be, and they basically produce these cables for the energy industry. Now they said, we just want to become a zero scrap company. So 3 to 6% of their production today is going as scrap, and they have no visibility. It's lying in some customer's location. It's lying somewhere here, there, wherever, everywhere. Now, how do we help them figure this out? Part of it can be reused for their own production. Part of it can be sold off to other people. Right? There are a lot of different things that can be done with it. But how do they do that? They have no systems to do it. And by the way, there's huge economic opportunity here because 3 to 6% of their production is 50 million in euro annually. Right? So it's a huge thing if we can figure it out. But of course, that's a challenge.
Do you have a question?
Thank you.
Thank you, Pronita. Can we have a big round of applause for all our speakers, please? Manu, Kavita, Swapnil, Venkatesh, and Pronita. Thank you. So, with this, we end our ninth edition. Like we said before, this edition on design, innovation, and disruption has been really special for us. This has been the last edition of 2017, and it has also been a part of the Disruptive Innovation Festival. We will be sending you the link where you can find our session online. You can view the video over there. And we will be planning our next year's events. We do events every odd month, second Tuesday of every odd month. If you have any questions, if you have any feedback, what we did well, what we would improve, please feel free to share it with us. Our volunteers are around at the registration desk and all over in the room. A big shout out and thank you to all our volunteers who have given their time and effort. Please have a round of applause for all of our volunteers. Hansika, Himangi, Sachin, Rohan, Karthik, Shreya, Shashank, I hope I've not missed anyone. And my name is Dhaval. Thank you so much for joining us today. Thank you.